Good morning. Welcome to Westminster Presbyterian Church. I'm Lori Baining, the Associate Pastor for Congregational Care. I hope that you have found your bulletin this morning and in your bulletin, the connection card, and invite you, whether you are a first-time visitor or a long-time member, to turn in the connection card in the offering bag when it comes around. We'd love to know if you have any new email address or a change of a cell phone number. That's always helpful for us. If you're a first-time visitor, share as much information as you're comfortable sharing. And if you are a first-time visitor, make sure you stop at one of the exits on the way out. We'll have a host or a hostess with a little goodie bag of information about our church and just a way to say welcome to you, too. Here at Westminster, it is always our hope and prayer that all would come to know Jesus Christ and that we would then grow as followers of Jesus Christ day by day, and then that we would be encouraged and motivated to go and to tell others that same good news that we have heard for ourselves, so that others can come to know Jesus Christ and grow in a relationship with him and go and tell others. You see the multiplication effect. That's what it's about, friends. It's not about somebody from another church who is unhappy there and coming here, right? We're winning, right? No. It's about bringing those who do not know Jesus to know the good news of Jesus Christ. In our bulletin today, you'll see in the green announcement sheet lots and lots of mission opportunities. It's so cool. Next week, Sunday, we have the opportunity to turn in our Operation Christmas Child shoebox. Don't forget about that. And then also today, in the gathering place, you can sign your name to a Christmas card for a couple of our mission partners that are connected with IJM. International Justice Ministries. If you want to stop out in the gathering place today, you can do that. And you'll see other opportunities too. Pregnancy Center has got something going on. Volunteer for a few hours at the Operation Christmas Child Collection Center. 60 Minutes Against Hunger event. The Youth Life Skills Christmas Party. Warm blankets needed for the gospel mission. Lots of different opportunities, ways that we can share the good news of Jesus Christ. Next week, Sunday afternoon, too, for families, it's Amy Winans, our Children's Ministries Director, is hosting a creative Christmas family gathering, Ways to Keep Christ in Christmas. You'll see that in there, too. I invite you to take note of that, whether you have children or grandchildren. That might be a good opportunity. And then today, too, we'll be turning in our pledge cards as the highlight of our stewardship, discipleship season. And I hope that you have brought your pledge card with to turn in this bottom amount, this bottom part here, with your financial pledge as well. We'll be doing that also, putting that in with the offering a little bit later in our service. That little offering bag is going to be pretty full today. Connection cards, regular offering, and pledge cards. Okay, so... So friends, let us come and worship God together. Would you pray with me? Holy God, we come to you in this place, grateful to be in your presence, grateful to be among brothers and sisters. God, on this day, open our ears, open our minds, open our hearts to the word that you have for us. And may we just give you all glory, all honor, and all praise in return. We pray this in the strong name of Jesus. And let all God's children say, Amen. Amen.
Exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name.
Let us all worship God together. Would you stand with me as we share in the call to worship? The words are found printed in your bulletin. From Psalm 62, "For God alone my soul waits in silence. From him comes my salvation.
He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be greatly shaken.
Trust in him at all times, O people. We will pour out our hearts before him. God is a refuge for us." Let us sing together hymn number 318, "Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing."
Seated. God is the source of all blessing. He has sought us out in Jesus Christ. He is so good to us. We do not always respond to him as he deserves. I invite you to turn in your bulletin to our prayer of confession. Let us go before the throne of grace. Let us pray. Gracious God, in love you created us to bear your image and to depend upon you. In love, you sent your Son Jesus among us as the light of the world, to reveal your love for all people. In love, you sought out the least and the last and the lost among us, claiming them as your own precious children. In love, you redeemed our brokenness upon the cross, holding none of your goodness back from us. In love, you triumphed over death and the grave, raising Jesus to life and offering his new life to us. You have treated us with nothing but love, yet we confess that we do not walk in this love as we should, for we have loved ourselves more than you. Forgive us, Lord. By your Holy Spirit, renew our hearts once more, so that we might follow Jesus as he continues to love this world, and so that our lives might be extensions of your love for all people. Amen. Brothers and sisters, hear once again the good news of the gospel. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. To God be the glory, now and forever. Amen.
What a gift it is that God makes a covenant with us, reaches out to us with his love and with his grace, all through the cross of Jesus Christ. Let's be reminded of that gift as we sing together hymn number 253, Beneath the Cross of Jesus. We will remain seated as we do so.
Thank you.
Would you pray with me? Holy God, you are the source of every blessing we enjoy. The streams of mercy that flow into our lives daily truly call for our loudest praises back to you. Jesus Christ, you sought us out when we were strangers to you, and you have rescued us from the abyss. May your goodness and grace be a magnet that binds our wandering hearts to you. Holy God, on this day, we first of all thank you for the rain. Thank you for the rain that our valley so desperately needs. And may the rain that falls down remind us of your constant blessings flowing into our lives. On this day, too, we rejoice with those who rejoice, those who have heard good news this week following a biopsy, those who are enjoying a new baby in the family, or a new son or daughter-in-law. We rejoice with those who are relishing in good health and the joy of close, supportive relationships. We weep too, Lord, with those who weep, those who are grieving the death of a loved one or who are devastated by serious health concerns. We weep with those who are struggling in their marriages or mourning children who have wandered far from you. For those dealing with change in their work situation, their living environment, their health or family situations, God, assure them of the constancy of your unchanging presence and your unfailing love. As we look to the larger world, we continue to pray for those who are grieving the death of loved ones in the Russian airliner crash. God, we pray for your justice towards those who may have caused the crash. And in our own country, we continue to pray for our national leaders. Give them wisdom. Give them a sense of your justice. We pray for a unity of purpose and for humility. God, remove from them the stubborn pride which imagines itself to be above and beyond criticism. And forgive them for the blunders they have committed. Holy God, fill each of us with your Holy Spirit. Use each of us to draw others to you, to your grace, to your love, to your forgiveness. Use us, God, to touch others, the lives of others, perhaps the person sitting next to us in the pew this morning, perhaps a neighbor that lives nearby, the person we work with, or the friend we share a meal with. Show us, God, how you want to use each of us to further your kingdom here on this earth. Because you have called us, God, each of us for a purpose. You have claimed us as your children, as sons and daughters. And so as your children, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you pray with me? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Lord God, God of love, you are so good to us to come and meet with us. Lord, I ask that you do that again now, opening your word to us that we might be transformed as it enters our lives, as we realize who you are. Lord, we love you. We pray yet again. Amen. Okay, so I realized first off that we are going to be skipping an awful lot to get here suddenly to Mark chapter 8 from where we were last week. We are skipping, among other things, the death of John the Baptist and the feeding of the 5,000 and Jesus walking on water and more healings and more exorcisms and teachings and confrontations with the Pharisees and connections with the unclean and the outcast. And you get the picture. We're skipping a lot. Encourage you to go back and read through the rest of that yourselves. You know, we knew that there was no way we could do a gospel or even a major portion of a gospel in 11 weeks. And in fact, this series is actually a week shorter than the last time we did it across, when I did it across the way there. So I actually had to cut out Jesus being rejected in his hometown, which I actually wrote the sermon for. If you want, I think it's online. He was rejected, by the way, for being too ordinary. You ever think that you're too ordinary? Just remember that we are sent out as Jesus. Just like I was sent, he said, so are you sent. So you might end up being rejected for being too ordinary. And then he sent the disciples out to be just like him. But here's the thing. The next 3 weeks are some of the most critical passages in Scripture. That other stuff is all great stuff, and I hate to skip it. But we just don't have enough time for everything. And these next three passages are incredible, definitive passages. In fact, this morning's passage, I would say, is truly one of the most significant passages in all of Scripture. If you want to understand the Christian faith, you must understand this passage this morning. That puts a little pressure on me, but I'm not saying I'm going to explain it all this morning. But, you know, we'll get started. This passage is the focal point of Mark. It's the hub around which everything else orbits, the center. If you want to understand Jesus, you must understand this passage. So, with that said, listen for the word of God, Mark chapter 8, verse 27 to chapter 9, verse 1. And Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they told him, "John the Baptist, and others say Elijah, and others one of the prophets." And he asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Christ." And he strictly charged them to tell no one about him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. And he said this plainly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on things of God, but on the things of man." And calling the crowd to him and his disciples, he said to them, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the Gospels will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father and the holy angels. And he said to them, truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God after it has come with power. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Such a lot going on in this passage, and we are not going to be able to unpack it all. It's just so much. But the question that Jesus asks is of critical importance. You see, Christianity is not a religion with a to-do list. Our faith is not a religion with a to-do list. It is a relationship. It is about our becoming new in relationship to Jesus himself. That is what Jesus has been doing all along in his ministry, showing his disciples and the people around him who he is, and inviting them, and through them, inviting us to follow him. That is, to be in relationship. Now he begins to lay out the big picture for his disciples of what that following is going to look like. But you notice that he doesn't talk programs. He doesn't talk about his past accomplishments. How he healed and freed and fed and saved. He doesn't talk about any of those things. And he doesn't talk about whether or not they understand his teaching. In fact, he knows that they don't understand his teaching a lot of the time. You know, what he starts talking about as he unfolds for them and explains to them what following him will be like is who himself he is himself, his own personal identity. That's what he starts talking about. Who am I? Who do people say that I am? Who do you say that I am? It seems like the disciples are starting to get it. Peter replies, you are the Messiah, you are the Christ. And this is a huge claim for Peter to make. The expectations of the Messiah had been building for close to 1,000 years among the Jewish people. They were actually several competing variations or visions of what the Messiah might be like, but they were all big visions. Some thought that he would be a super prophet, bringing his people back to God to establish true justice and true righteousness in Israel and for the world for once and for all. Some others thought that he would be a super priest, a divine messenger who would finally deal with the sin of Israel and establish true worship once and for all. Others thought that he would be a super king, a conquering hero who would finally throw out the Romans and all the rest of the enemies of Israel and bring Israel to preeminence over the whole world once and for all. Prophet, priest, king, competing visions, and yet all huge visions. So when Peter makes the claim that Jesus is in fact the Messiah, it is an astounding claim that he is the Christ. And Jesus basically says, yes, that is who I am. In fact, he will end up fulfilling all of the prophecies about the Messiah, prophet, priest, and king. He's just going to end up doing them in ways that the people don't expect. But Jesus says, don't tell anyone. And then as if he had been waiting for them all along to finally reach this confessional point where they finally understand that he is the Messiah, he begins to teach them what it will mean for him to be the Messiah. What this road will actually look like. Because it's surprising. It's nothing like what they had heard about the Messiah before. Don't get me wrong. It's there in Scripture. It's there in the prophecies. But it's conveniently ignored as we look at the glory of the Messiah. See, Jesus is not talking power and glory and the whole world loving him. That's not what his road will look like, he says. He talks about pain and suffering and the whole world hating him. He doesn't talk about victory and conquest and taking the throne to rule over people. He talks about a cross and death for those people. And it's a different vision. And Jesus not only says this will happen, he says it must happen. Very important word there. Must happen. Why must it happen? Why did Jesus go to the cross? Why did Jesus have to die? Well, there are the practical historical reasons that are brought up so often, that he ran afoul of the religious authorities, that he was betrayed by a malcontent in his own group, that he was perceived as a threat to the peace by the Romans, that his good nature was just fundamentally incompatible with our corrupt social structures, and so they all conspired to get rid of him. It's what we so often hear from historians today. And all those explain why Jesus might have been killed. But Jesus doesn't give us a, I might die, or even I will die. He gives us a, I must die. And it's just fundamentally different. In fact, the Greek word is a strong word that is often associated with a thing being a natural outflow of a particular situation or nature. Okay, that's a definition. Let me make it more accessible. Fish gotta swim. Birds gotta fly. Jesus has gotta die. He must, because it's who he is. It could even be translated, it is God's will that he die, that this happen, that Jesus as Christ must go to the cross because he was made for it. He was meant for it. And this little word shows us that this wasn't just an unfortunate side effect of his being a radical teacher or a rebellious reformer, but that it was his purpose to die all along. It was why he came to earth. He doesn't just know that it's coming, he actually seeks out the cross for our sakes. You know, we often just say Jesus died for our sins, and that's true. It's what Jesus and the New Testament writers and the Old Testament prophets all point to. But why must he die for our sins? Why must he die? Why can't God just say, well, it's all good, you're all forgiven. Let's just let bygones be bygones and forget about it. Why must he die? So I have to confess a significant level of intimidation as we look at this question. This is one of the questions that trips up people all the time. This is one of the most important questions in all of living, the doctrine of the atonement. It's central to who we are as Christians. And frankly, we could have a 10-week seminary-level class on this doctrine alone and still not get to the bottom of it. It's so great. Or for that matter, we could get a couple of different theologians and put them in a cage for a knock-down, drag-out, winner-take-all deathmatch fight, and they probably do it. Because we have a lot of theologians out there who really disagree over the doctrine of the atonement. What does it mean? See, some say Christ died on the cross to conquer the powers of hell and evil. Christus Victor is what it's called in Latin. Or did he die to show solidarity with us in the midst of our sufferings? Christus Dolor. Or did he die to set an example for us? Christus Exemplar. Or did he die as a scapegoat for all our sins? And I don't remember the Latin for that one, if there is. As if all of this has to be an either or. Like the God who created galaxies and DNA can't somehow multitask when it comes to saving us. The reality is Jesus is doing a lot on the cross. And all of what I just said is true. He did die to conquer hell and death. He did die for our sins. He did die as an example to show us what it means to be a man of God, to give yourself for God. In fact, he invites us to do the same, to take up our own cross and sacrifice for the sake of the people around us, even though they don't deserve it. But anyway, I think you see some of the things that Jesus was to accomplish on the cross when you actually look back at his ministry and see what he has been accomplishing all along. So let's just highlight a few of those things. Why did Jesus come in the first place, and what was it that he was doing, and how did it culminate on the cross? First of all, motive. Love. It's very simple. Why did Jesus come? Love. And for us, to give us a new identity that's rooted and grounded in love. We saw this in our first week when we looked at his baptism in the Jordan River, this Trinitarian action surrounding that baptism. Our God is a triune God, an eternal community of love, perfect in self-giving, upbuilding, honoring relationship. God doesn't in any way need us. He does not need you. That means that all of his actions with us, his actions for you, are free gifts of gracious love. We were meant to be defined by God's love and to live in the freedom of his love. And that is what he is doing. He is establishing love as the foundation once and for all. And we humans have a tough time truly accepting God's love. We have chosen to live in ways that are defined by ourselves instead of by God. And in the end, we reap the results of our self-focused lives. We are alone. We wrestle with self-rejection and self-hatred and poor self-esteem and emptiness and anger and depression and loneliness and in the end, death. Every single one of us wrestles with this. You know this, right? You live this. If we lock ourselves into our own limited selves, we will die. We are inherently limited. We are not self-sustaining creatures, but we were built for dependence. And we instinctively know that we are meant for more, but we're not quite sure how to get there. And so we keep building and strengthening the walls of our own self. In fact, this is what our culture says. Build up yourself. Build up your ego. Feel better about yourself. But we can't. Because we can't do it alone in our own selves. And we get all knotted up trying to protect ourselves from the brokenness of the world and from the brokenness that is found rooted deep within our own hearts. Every single one of us wrestles with this. And we get ourselves thinking that the only one who's going to look out for me is me. We all think this. Even in the midst of a happy married relationship, there are times you say, well, you know, I got to watch out for myself because she's not going to do it or he's not going to do it. In the most intimate of relationships, we're still looking out for ourselves. How can we break through that problem? I mean, don't get me wrong, we try our best to love each other because we know we need it. But we're not able to accomplish it perfectly. And so those loves that we build with each other don't satisfy us. They can't satisfy us. We still watch out and make sure we're not getting the short end of the stick, and we revoke our love if we don't think it's being appreciated by the other. In small ways sometimes, in major ways other times. I know I'm making gross generalizations here, but honestly, look at your relationships with other people. What happens when the people around you are not returning your love in a way that you feel is adequate? What happens? What happens in your own heart when you feel that you're not being treated well? We pull back. We stop our love. And the only thing that is strong enough to break through this fortress of stone that we've built around our own hearts is true love. And we can't get that from each other. And then along comes Jesus, God's love made flesh. And he doesn't need a thing from us. Instead, he offers himself freely for us upon the cross, dying an innocent death in pure, unblemished love. And that love has the power finally to break our hearts of stone. And at the same time, to give us the security we need to start to love others like we've been loved by him. And that's one of the reasons that Jesus must die, to show us the depths of true love, of God's love for us. God is love, and it redefines who we are. His willingness to do whatever it takes to secure us once more in his love, to redefine us by that love. That's one of the reasons Jesus must die. There's no other way for us to see the depths of God's love. The second reason is a legal reason. The reality is that there is a debt incurred each and every time we become that self-centered person, when we hurt each other. There's a debt that is incurred. As a race, we've incurred this debt. But we also do it as individuals every day. We've damaged each other and ourselves in the process of being selfish. And those hurts don't just disappear. So say, just for an example, you're driving home today and you get a little distracted and you don't notice that the car in front of you has stopped and you plow right into it. You and the driver get out of the car and you look at the damage to both of your cars because there's real damage. Now you have three basic options. First of all, the person can look at you and say, yeah, okay, you're a bad driver. See what you've done. You broke the law. You wrecked my car. It's your fault. You need to pay for it. Right? That's the first option. That's the usual option. You're at fault. You have to pay for it. And you have to pay the penalty to fix the car or both cars. Or the second option, maybe the person is feeling generous and they say, oh, don't worry about it. I'll take care of it. I'll pay to fix my car. And they pay to fix their own car. Or third, perhaps you both look at the damage and say, eh, it's not great, it's not ideal, but it's still drivable. We'll just drive around with damaged cars. Which means that you're both paying by driving damaged cars. Right? So one way or the other, somebody has to pay to fix the cars. What is not an option in this case is that you drive away and your cars magically fix themselves. There's real damage. It doesn't just go away. Friends, sin causes real damage in our lives. Just because you cannot see the damage on the other person that you've hurt, they physically look the same, but you've just hurt them, just because you cannot see the damage, does not mean it is not there. It leaves a lasting effect upon another person. It leaves a lasting effect upon your heart. When you become selfish and you hurt another being, it hurts you too. It breaks our hearts. It twists our minds. It racks our bodies. There is a price to be paid, a debt that is incurred, both to the person we wrong and to the God who made us and who also made that other person. The problem is that these are debts that we are incapable of setting right. How can you pay to fix another person's soul? There's not a convenient mechanic down the road who can take your soul out and fix it. Only God can fix us. You know, as I grow older, I am becoming more acutely aware not only of how I have hurt people in the past, but how I continue to hurt people, even as a pastor, even as one who has dedicated my life to the glory of Jesus Christ. I want nothing more than to honor Him, and yet I still hurt the people around me. Paul, again, talks about this. Who will save me from the body of this death? Whether we intentionally hurt people or hurt them through ignorance or hurt them through incompetence, it doesn't matter. They have been hurt. We have been hurt. Sometimes the wronged person retaliates from their own hurt, and that doesn't erase the debt. If they do a commensurate amount of damage to you, it doesn't erase the damage that's been done to them. It just starts a new cycle of violence, and we see this in our world all the time. This cycle of abused becoming the abuser, the cycle of hatred going back and forth and increasing. Who can possibly break this cycle of hurt, of law being broken, of debt being incurred? As we have been seeing throughout Mark's gospel, Jesus came to reassert God's authority over all areas of our life. He came to set right the brokenness that comes through a people who still refuse to live by God's law. His coming would be really bad news if we were still rebels against God with debts that we can't pay. And so, God Himself must take that hurt. See, Jesus looks at the wreckage of the human race, and instead of passing judgment, He says, I myself will pay this debt. I will absorb all of the garbage into myself, and the debt will be no more. I will take it up on the cross. He is the only one who could do it, and he was willing to do it. And so suddenly you are free to start healing. When another person hurts you, you don't have to retaliate. You don't have to become defensive. You can say, Jesus Christ has taken all of this garbage, and he has a future for me that is secure. I will make it through this hurt, knowing that he has taken even my hurt. You're free to surrender to God without fear because the penalty is already paid. You're free to stop trying to be God yourself and to give your life to the one who actually is God. You're free to offer forgiveness to others just as it was offered to you in Jesus Christ. You're free to take up your own cross and eat the anger that comes at you. I know it sounds horrible, but that's what Jesus did for us, to take it in and say, I will not react. I will not lash out at you. I will not even judge you. I will love you instead and break the cycle. Because that's what God in Jesus Christ did for you. That's what Jesus is saying. Take up your own crosses. Start dealing with this offensive, angry, broken, sinful world in the same way that I have done it for you. Take what I have done and replicate it. Start a new cycle, a cycle that brings life and forgiveness and reconciliation. Don't let angers fester. Don't bear grudges. Instead, remember the freedom that's been given to you upon the cross and extend that freedom to the very enemies that come at you. Love your enemy is one of the most radical phrases that humankind has ever heard. And because of the cross, it's possible. And because of the cross, it makes a difference. It breaks the cycle. Okay, while Jesus Christ offers forgiveness instead of judgment, he's also not okay to leave brokenness to continue on unchecked. So there's a third way that he must die. This is another reason that Christ had to come to die, to be victorious over the very powers that drive the suffering and brokenness in our world, to set people up against those powers. While human sin is profoundly personal, there's also a sense in which it becomes institutional, ingrained in the very fabric of our lives. We've seen Jesus confronting those systems throughout his ministry. If you look through the gospel, you will see him standing up against unjust systems, whether it's a dispassionate and ritualistic religious system or the actual demons terrorizing people. Jesus is not okay to leave those people in chains. And so Jesus took those powers out on the cross, and he showed how powerless they were. It says, Scripture says, he made a public spectacle out of them upon the cross, ultimately freeing us from their power. Okay, so how do we take hold of these victories? That Jesus came to set us free in his love, that he wiped away the law that was against us, freeing us to respond in grace, just as grace has been given to us, and how he has liberated us from the cosmic powers. I know we could go into a lot more detail here. We don't have the time, obviously. What do we do to understand these powers, the liberation that Jesus has brought us? These victories that Christ won on the cross. First of all, we have to understand that these victories take hold of us first. They come as already accomplished realities that Jesus gives to us. This is why we hear the New Testament writer saying over and over and over again, this is who you are, not this is who you will become. You know, the writers don't say, you someday will be holy ones, the saints. They say, you are holy ones, the saints. This is who you are now. Now live like it. Live like you're redeemed people. Too often we try to get it the other direction. We say, if I can only live a certain way, if I can only do this, if I can only do that, then I will be. In fact, this thing right here, don't let this thing become for you a list of things that you have to do in order to feel loved and valued by God. Feel loved and valued by God, and so commit yourself to be that person that he's made you to be. It's so important we get it in the right order. The second thing is we understand that as this reality comes to us, as we are and then do out of that, that we become part of the cycle. We repent and believe. We become that person that we already are, if that makes sense. Jesus has defined us. Now we take part actively in pursuing that identity. repent and believe, to understand who I am and to start living into and trusting God. Put our faith in Him on a daily basis and allow that to define how I live. So instead of expecting others to demonstrate certain achievements in order to receive my favor, I'm going to be like Jesus. I'm going to love them as they are and help them to grow in all of their messiness towards the person God wants them to be. Does that make sense? Show them the same grace that God has given to me, understanding that they are before they can become as well, that God has defined them as well. Instead of judging the people around me, I'm free to offer grace because I know how broken I was and what it cost Jesus Christ to offer grace to me on the cross, why He must die. Instead of being locked into individual outcomes or individual moments, I can remember that God has an eternal cosmic plan for me and for the people around me, and I can just relax a little bit and love people. Right here and right now, God is working in us. That we are getting way more than we deserve, and so I can offer more than the people around me deserve. Which is going to cost us something, and let's just close with this. Acting like Jesus in this world will cost you something. Yes, people will take advantage of you. Yes, you will offer grace and people will stomp all over you. It's going to hurt. It's going to cost you something to forgive a person instead of holding on to a grudge. It will cost you something. It'll cost you a cross. And that's exactly what Jesus says. He must come and die so that we can be in relationship with Him. We must take up our crosses so that we can continue that relationship with the people around us. God's sacrificial love through the cross of Jesus Christ gives us a whole new identity. Let us live into that identity. As Jesus came to die, let us offer ourselves in love to the people around us. Let's pray. Lord God, it's so hard to preach this word. It's hard to live this. But Lord, we pray that in Your grace and mercy, You would be with us to allow us to take up the pains and the brokenness of the people around us, that Your love might be triumphant in their lives as well. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. God in Jesus Christ has given us everything, and He held nothing back. Today is a day of Consecration Sunday in which we offer ourselves back to God in Jesus Christ, saying we will strive with the Holy Spirit's help to become the people that Jesus Christ has already created us to be, has already defined us in His grace by His cross to be. I invite you to take out your pledge cards, and as the offering comes around, to place those in, dedicating yourself to be God's people in this day and on. Let's take the offering. Let's make our pledge. Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, we offer these gifts to you. We offer our financial gifts. We offer our pledges to you, God. And again, we're not trying to earn your love. We're not trying to push our way into heaven. God, this is simply our response to the amazing gift of love and grace that you have already given to us. So God, empower us and just give us the passion to live the lives that you have already created for us to live. And we pray this through the strong name of Jesus Christ. And let all God's people say,
Amen.
Let us close in our final hymn, number 260, And Can It Be That I Should Gain?
Thank you.
Okay, so we wrestled with some deep theology today. Let me just simplify it. You've been shown amazing love, brought you life. Now go out and give the same exact love that God in Jesus Christ upon the cross gave to you, to every single person you meet, in every single situation you encounter, and you will be a disciple. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you this day and every day. Amen. Go in peace.